The topic of today's webinar is a simplified guide to increasing your chances of survival in battles with tax authorities. Our speaker for today's webinar is esteemed Professor Dr. Hans van den Herk. He's an independent tax strategist with Cygnus Tax and also a professor of European Corporate Income Taxes and International Tax Policy Strategy at Maastricht University. Professor, I now invite you to continue with this presenting this webinar.
Ladies and gentlemen, good day, because for some of you it's morning, for some of you it's afternoon. Welcome to this webcast. What I'm going to try to give you is an overview on what we can do to help you overcome issues with the tax administration. And in order to do so, we probably first have to start a little bit with an update of the things currently going on within OECD, United Nations, EU, etc., etc. So perhaps you can go to the first slide. Current state of affairs. You all know that this spring is getting very important because the last part of the spring, the multilateral instrument of OECD is going to be signed in Paris, and when I say has going to be signed...
Professor, just one second. Apparently there is no audio.
Ladies and gentlemen, with apologies, the technology didn't work out that well. My name is Hans van den Hurk. I am going to present on ways how and where we can help you overcoming all kinds of international tax issues. And in order to do so, I think it's important to start actually with giving you a little bit of an overview of where we are, the current state of affairs with international tax law. So perhaps the next slide. Yes. All of you know that in June of this year, in Paris, OECD wants the countries to sign the multilateral instrument. You know, the multilateral instrument it contains actually all issues from the BEPS reports, although most issues, I have to say, of which part of the issues, like anti-abuse and the current establishment, are so-called default issues, which means that countries have to implement them. Well, that MLI is going to be quite an issue, since already for weeks we hear more and more rumors of countries not wanting to sign that multilateral instrument. What does it mean? More in detail, whenever you would go to the MLI, you will see in Article 28 that countries can make reservations on the MLI, and apparently almost all countries are going to apply all possible reservations, including making some reservations on issues they cannot make reservations on. As a consequence, the MLI is not going to be, to say the least, the thing OECD wants us to be. Is that good news? Well, yes and no. I have more things to tell you about this, but the good news is that there are a few issues in the MLI which are difficult to understand. But the bad news is, on the other hand, that because the MLI is not going to be accepted, more and more states will go their own way. And that again leads to differences, because all the states are going to implement one way or another parts of the OECD BEPS reports. But whenever they do it on their own way, you get differences in laws. And that has a lot of consequences for the position of any company in this world. One of the main discussions currently going on is a discussion in the United States, where, as you know, President Trump is working on a tax reform. Basis, at least this is expected of the tax reform, as a territorial system with a repatriation holiday going on for working for 1 year at approximately 5% for dividend repatriation. Also, for passive foreign income, a direct taxation in the US, but as I said, for active income, just a territorial system. And to give you one example, whenever you would look at Action 7, the permanent establishment, later on we have a slide on this topic, but permanent establishment, the commission agent permanent establishment, or the commission agent discussions, US multinationals use them a lot. As a consequence of the approach of more and more states with regarding permanent establishment, the actual tax basis, which sometimes doesn't exist yet and sometimes is quite limited, for permanent establishment will clearly increase. For US multinationals, this is going to mean that also for them this will increase. And of course, after a tax reform in the US, it's clear that many principles will go back to the US, the structures, but as a consequence, that will probably deliver benefits to US multinationals. On the other hand, they will see that elsewhere in the world, they will be confronted with a higher tax burden. And this is one of the main reasons why US is also one of the states which is going to push the brake here. To what extent and how it's going to work, we still don't know yet. I can just tell you that there are some unconfirmed rumors that the US is very angry on OECD and even has threatened to cancel its membership, which would probably mean a very difficult situation here. So that's about US. Within United Nations, the developments are still going strong. A very important element later on the slide is the fact that in Article 1 of the Model Tax Convention, they will insert the principal purpose test, and I'll explain later how very tough that's going to be for the tax practice. Further on, later this year in New York and in Geneva, discussions will continue on the technical service permit establishment, but also on an updated transfer pricing manual from the United Nations. And with the the European Union, as you might have noticed, the Anti-Tax Avoidance Directive number 2 has been published, which deals with hybrids in a third country relation, the CVBV structures, for example, used with the Netherlands. So many new developments, with probably the most important one, the tough discussions within OECD. Whenever we would look at kind of issues, kind of disputes practice can give, we have two categories. First of all, new ones due to these new international tax principles, and that's the big category. But also there is a existing one based on specific issues in specific countries. Whenever you have a transfer pricing report on India, probably India will have its own position because they only accept, for example, domestic databases, and other countries have a different view and so on and so on. One example later on this topic. So, but the new ones are the ones based on all the changes currently taking place within the European Union, within the US, with the US Model Tax Convention, within Asia, following the United Nations developments, within Latin America, partially following the OECD developments, but partially also going their own way. And that's a category which I will focus on later, because that's the most important one where we can add value, probably. Well, how to handle tax disputes? We actually have three categories of discussing this. First of all, you can just go to the tax administration and negotiate a solution, being discussed later. The second one is the mediation one. Mediation is a tough topic in the MLI. Recently, you've had that webcast of Transfer Pricing Associates with Hans Mooy discussing the mediation procedure in the MLI. And but also, within the United Nations, you will see that mediation is going to be one of the main solutions they are bringing forward. And surprisingly, I've been there when these United Nations countries discussed this. Surprisingly, they actually seem to have found each other there, and there's hardly any discussion that mediation is a good solution. And I'm mentioning this simply because within OECD, as you know, although OECD believes that 90% of all tax disputes can be solved with the dispute resolution part of the MLI, in practice, we just don't believe that, simply because not all countries are using and accepting this solution. And of course, the third one are the court battles. We will later explain how to deal with this. So the idea is to explain a little bit now about the sort of cases we can see coming up to the world, cases which we will all see in our practices, and how we can deal with this, and how we can probably help you with specific knowledge on these issues. And yeah, probably let's go to the next slide. So whenever you go, I already discussed the development. So whenever you go to the MLI, just to give you a little bit more information on where the new cases will be visible. Default and the non-default position is an invention of OECD. Default is any state has to accept the anti-abuse provisions as being mentioned in the MLI and has to accept the permanent establishment issues described in Action 7, though with a few exceptions for a different position. And as said, it's now going to get more and more mixed up. But still, this is one of the main issues, because any state will nowadays have some anti-abuse provision, at least will try to have an anti-abuse provision in its tax treaties, or will even already just apply an anti-abuse provision, even that's not mentioned in the treaty. That's already what we notice, even with some EU states at the moment. So from the other issues which are part of the OECD, you will see that CFC and EBITDA are two issues which are basically non-default positions, where CFC is open to the countries, and you see some movement here and there within the EU based on the first anti-tax avoidance directive. With respect to EBITDA, there was recently, this week actually, a tax reform proposal within the UK on introducing the EBITDA over there. But you still have to know that although everybody accepts the EBITDA rules, although it's not in the MLI, since every country seems to implement this, within the European Union, we have still this case for the German Constitutional Court, which has to decide on the acceptability, whether the EBITDA as such is acceptable from a burden to pay principle. And we expect that the Constitutional Court will actually reject the EBITDA arrangement, simply because it's, to German perspective, it seems to be unconstitutional. As a consequence, Finland has just copied the German one, but even whatever's going to happen, whenever it's unconstitutional in Germany, Germany cannot implement, so we will have get new discussions on the EBITDA also on a European basis, probably. As said, the developments in the United Nations PPT in new Article 1 and the technical services one. The PPT I will address a little bit later. So, tax treaties, what are we going to see? Well, one of the most important, basic, probably new things for many states is the NDBU's thing. There has to be a statement in any treaty that the treaty is not intended to accept situations which can be abusive or even can be tax avoidance schemes. So, the difficulty between tax avoidance and tax evasion is getting more vague. So there is tax avoidance is now actually categorized in two categories, acceptable tax avoidance and non-acceptable tax avoidance. And that's quite a difficult situation since tax evasion is not per definition just fraud. It can be a situation that you pass a line, and in tax avoidance, you know, you actually have to distinguish also in two categories. So that's a basic phrase, and I assume that more and more states will include in the treaty some anti-abuse provision. That brings us with the principal purpose test and the simplified limitation on the benefits provision. The principal purpose test, I have a case later on, is a killer. It's a killer under the current EU directive on the parent subsidiary. It's going to be a killer under the MLI whenever it's going to be accepted, but still it's going to be accepted in another way, probably. And it's a killer under the new United Nations Model Tax Convention. And why? Because it's not clear what it is. Let me just give you one example. Principal purpose test means that you have to look at the purposes why you would actually have a structure in place in which you use a specific country. So you then have to test whether the principal purpose for using the country is the tax system or not. So, and in principle, there are more purposes why you would use a country. So it could be infrastructure, it could be education, it could be the climate, it could be everything. And so there are more principal purposes to use a country. So the question then remains to be answered, how do you define what's the principal purpose? Or is just any situation where tax is a reason enough to say the principal purpose is tax? In the MLI, in the instructions for implementing the MLI, you will see that OECD actually says, well, principal purpose, main purpose, or primary purpose, for us it's all the same. That's in a way good news, because when primary purpose is intended, which is in conflict actually with Action 6 of OECD, but still in the MLI they have a different opinion. So when primary purpose would be the purpose of the change of law of OECD, then there's only one strong purpose, and that could be tax. And whenever tax is just one of the many purposes, then it's not the primary purpose, and therefore the PPT goes, it's not as strong as we expect this to be. As said, the experience currently under the European Parent Subsidiary Directive is, for example, states like Italy, Spain, and Portugal direct in a different way. They see the principal purpose not as the primary, the PPT, but as the principal purpose. Why? Simply because whenever you see it as the principal purpose, as once intended in Action 6, a country has a broader perspective and more possibilities to actually challenge the position of a taxpayer. So it's a difficult discussion here. And also with the United Nations, this discussion is an issue. And as I said, I have a slide later on. And it's even worse. Well, I can already probably address it in a few words. Where in the OECD perspective, the principal purpose test is only applicable in relation to Articles 10 to 12, so the passive categories of income. Although, again, in the MLI, here and there, they have a different opinion, but was once intended just to address 10 to 12, you will see that in United Nations, it's Article 1, which means that if, for example, Taiwan believes that the parent company, the intermediary company in the Netherlands, is in the Netherlands because one of the principal purposes is tax, then the Dutch company is no longer a resident under a tax convention, and therefore the whole treaty is not applicable anymore. And in that situation, even arbitration is impossible. So, because that's also based in the United Nations situation on a applicable treaty. So that it gives, so the PPT as such in EU, in OECD, in UN, gives so many different approaches of abuse that it's going to be quite important, difficult to really see what the outcome could be. In OECD, there's also the possibility for countries to implement a simplified limitation on benefits provision. OECD has said, fine, the US perspective of the new full LOB provision of the US is too complicated for countries. So let's go to a simplified version. And then the question is, whenever you would look at a simplified version, that any intermediary company receiving income from a subsidiary will have difficulties to actually comply in such a way that you can really make sure that you have the treaty benefits. And then you'll find something like, for those category of companies, there is a provision which says that whenever the intermediary, for example, the Netherlands, besides passive income, also creates substantial active income, then you can still enjoy the treaty benefits. But nobody actually knows what substantial means. I can just give you a Dutch interpretation. Substantial could mean 30% or more. Some would probably say substantial means 70% or more. And you could also say 50% or more. Nobody knows. There's no instruction at all on how to deal with this. So that's the SLOB. So it's vague, vague, and vague. And that's one of the reasons why states go their own way, why you will see that they will implement part of the principles, but in a different way. But still, the basis is the old principles as being described in, for example, Action 6, or Action 8 to 10, or Action 7 for the permanent establishment situations. So I'm going to address with you a few discussions which you could get with the tax administration. And of course, due to time reasons, I cannot discuss them all. I will just address these few in a few, these four in a few words, in order to give you a little bit of the flavor. So first of all, Article 4 on the MLI, which is about a dual residence situation. And whenever you would read this text, you will see in first instance that not too many things of a text treaty are going to change. But then please read the line in red. And you will see that effective management, the place where the corporation is incorporated or otherwise constituted, or other relevant factors still determine where a corporation is a resident. But then the next line, and you all know in how many times that more states actually say that corporation has its seat in my country. And then you'll see here that in the absence of an agreement between states on which state is the winner state for the residency, such person, so the corporation, shall not be entitled to any relief or exemption from tax provided by the covered tax agreement, except to the extent and in such manner as may be agreed upon by the competent authorities. So it could be the consequence that both states say, the corporation is a resident in my state, I am the winner state, thus, and the competent authority cannot find a solution. What does it mean for the corporation? Well, actually, my advice would strongly be that you make sure that these states come to a solution, because otherwise you have a much more worse problem. That's the issue regarding the dual residency. Permanent establishments. I just did a course for a multinational in 4 2-hour sessions just on permanent establishment issues, so 8 hours with a huge texting. So please allow me to do it in 5 minutes and understand that I cannot address all items. But first of all, what's going to change? Construction permanent establishment. 180 days, 360 days, you know, all these provisions in tax conventions. And you know that many companies try to circumvent this rule by just splitting up the contracts and see what you can do. And you know that already in the existing treaties, you will find solutions where they say, well, splitting of contracts is not possible for one or more reasons. And apparently it doesn't work that way. So OECD came up with a solution that in a situation where the splitting up of the contracts takes place, that states can actually apply here, and here it's again, the principal purpose test to see whether the principal purpose of splitting up the contracts was to actually avoid the existence of permanent establishment. And with that new provision, you will see that splitting of contracts, whenever you still would apply this, that is going to be even more difficult in the future. Service permanent establishments is already an issue, actually, because in a 5-3-B United Nations Model Tax Convention, you will see that 180 days of servicing leads to permanent establishment. So suppose you're Siemens and you have healthcare machines, or Samsung, and you sell a X-ray machine to Peru. The Peruvian government could look at the sale to the hospital and say, okay, I see people from Samsung here actually installing this X-ray machine and working in Peru for more than 180 days. So I see a Samsung permanent establishment in Peru, and I want to tax part of the profit in Peru. This service PE is probably going to change because India is putting pressure on the United Nations to limit the number of days from 180 to 90 days, which will even increase the difficulties of this, since you get in a much earlier stage already permanent establishment. Secondly, besides service permanent establishments, United Nations is working on, it looks like the same thing, but something completely different, the technical services permanent establishment. And that is the new Article 16 in the Model Tax Convention. In the discussion in Geneva in October last year, this new Article 16, which addresses situations where you pay money from state A to state B for all kinds of support you received, and the intention is then that the United Nations states say we want to levy withholding tax on that. So currently a withholding tax is normally levied just on dividend, interest or royalties. They would also to levy this on service payments. Well, this typical thing is already practiced, since in one of the examples later on, I will discuss with you a case, Nokia Finland actually, where you see that India actually perceives payments already from India to other states under the royalty article as a royalty. And this is actually the discussion currently going on within the United Nations, since in October, after 1 year of discussions, many states said, we don't want Article 16, the Technical Services Permanent Establishment, to be implemented. We just will address Article 12. So what's the difference for you as a client, as a company? Nothing at all. This just means that any payment from state A to state B which is not under the scope of 10, 11, or 12, will probably be taxed under 12 or under the new Article 16. So you can imagine that whenever this withholding tax is being levied, that the recipient state is not accepting this simply because the payer state is expanding its rights under the tax treaty, which is not allowed, and therefore they won't, the recipient state is not going to accept the tax credit. So double taxation is also here in consideration. Let's go to the auxiliary preparatory activities. You know that the MLI provides us with two alternatives under 5.4, an expanded current alternative based on the current rules, and a more diverted profits tax kind of a alternative is described in Action 7. And you know also that there is a diverted profits tax in the United Kingdom, which is followed by Australia. And the approach of the UK and Australia is different from the two approaches as offered in the MLI. And that's one of the reasons why we knew already for a few weeks that the UK has difficulties accepting the MLI because they want a different approach. We know that Germany has the same issue currently simply because companies like BMW and Mercedes have 10,000s of cars on fields somewhere in China waiting to be sold, and that would create permanent establishment risk. Therefore, we are not going to accept also these kind of changes. And this is also one of the breakers why probably the MLI is not going to be accepted. But still, is it good news? Does it bring clarity about auxiliary preparatory? No, nothing at all, because currently we have at least three systems in place. So some states, probably even four, some states will keep the old 5.4 in line, some states will use the new 5.4 version 1 or the new 5.4 version 2. UK and Australia probably have their own diverted profits tax, so four or five systems could be applicable. And you could say, okay, but we discuss here bilateral tax treaties, which means that both states have to agree on it. But still, wording is now and then vague, and therefore the interpretation of the same wording can lead to a different implementation, to a different meaning from the one state or the other state. So many issues to be expected here. The agency permit establishment 5556 is probably an issue, as I mentioned, for example, United States-based companies, because they see actually that under the new Trump rules, which are going to present it within probably 2 weeks now, a active system, a territorial system for active income means that they need to lower the non-US taxable basis as much as they can in order to benefit most of the new US tax system. And what we see here is that under the new MLI and under the new United Nations rules, actually their foreign tax base is just going to be expanded in a way they don't like, which doesn't fit the U.S. tax perspective. That's why whenever you would read the new U.S. tax convention of 2016, Article 5, you will see that they don't want to change. They still have the old-fashioned rules in it. And client-based taxation is something you probably don't know. You can probably remember that OECD suggested a 5.8, which was focusing on insurance companies. That provision hasn't been accepted, although it's part currently already of the United Nations Model Tax Convention. It actually means that when an insurance company in country A via the internet sells insurance premiums to policies to country B, the profit made in country B, although there's no fixed place, there's no permanent establishment at all, no agent, it's just a website in country A, still country B can tax the benefit created by that client base. And more states, of course India is leading this debate again, more and more states want the digital economy discussion to be solved by just taxing the tax base as such. Just one example, I'm a Dutch guy, as you might hear. In the Netherlands, Amazon is a big company selling many, many, many things, hundreds of thousands of deals per year, creating a lot of profit from Dutch-based clients, and we cannot tax them because there is nothing at all in the Netherlands. And in the future, it's probably going to be that more and more states within the European Union, France is working on this, Italy is working on this, is going to be based on client-based taxation. So suppose country A is going to levy client-based taxation, which is in a way a different approach to permanent establishments. What is the response of country B? What does it mean for the company? How will double taxation arise? And what can you do to moderate it? Okay, let's go to the withholding taxes.
Can I just ask a question? I'm not sure whether everybody can hear it, but does that mean if we're going to client-based taxation that a company like Amazon should be registered in all countries where the clients are based?
In principle, they are already due to probably VAT reasons, yeah. So they already should be. So it's an easy point to connect, so this is what I already discussed. Article 1 of the Principal Purpose of the United Nations, the issue we have under a PPT and already have under the Parent Subsidy Directive, for example, is that tax is always an issue. Any subsidiary under an Irish, a Luxembourg, a Belgium, a Dutch, a UK corporation is there because the intermediary also chose that location for tax reasons. More and more states tend therefore to just say, okay, fine, under OECD rules we cannot limit the withholding tax to be levied. So you will just go to the full withholding tax. As a consequence, The burden is on the payer country, which is actually the burden of the recipient country that's withholding taxes. However, the recipient states are not always willing to credit the additional withholding taxes simply because they believe that the payer state is incorrectly applying the tax treaty. So that's another issue where a lot of issues are arising. Under the Parent Subsidiary Directive, later on, one of the examples I will give to you, already a few cases are pending, and that directive only started to apply in January last year. So to give you just a flavor of how important it's going to be. So don't expect tax credits to be available. Sometimes there will be some states, probably the Netherlands, but probably also not, it will say, okay, fine, we see the issue, we will just credit the additional taxation. And sometimes states are going to negotiate with each other what to do with this. But also, in many times, you will see that double taxation will just be a given fact, and then you have to challenge this. Okay, let's go to the... another one is the increased... the substance issue. Of course, under the new tax rules, for just mentioning the DENPI functions is in a way one of the illustrations where you see that, okay, fine, your royalties are in country A. So, okay, what the development enhancement maintenance protection expectation demonstrate to us what you actually do there in order whether we accept the fact that we have to pay to that country and actually accept the fact that a residual, for example, is in the state where the IP would be. But also domestically, it's getting more and more an issue. And for example, within the European Union, based on the Parent Subsidy Directive, the anti-abuse provision, which is also going to be expanded to the Internal Royalty Directive, you see that countries like the Netherlands have increased substance criteria, and they will apply them whenever they need. And that means that it could lead in unexpected way, later on again a case, to a situation which you didn't expect, and where you probably have to go to the court. As said, I will have later a case. Yes. Back, sorry. Let me see whether I... that's the problem with substance. It's known that some U.S. multinationals have flown planes with people to these beautiful islands in the Caribbean in order to create substance, but just headcount is not sufficient, because you have to have people who really perform the relevant functions, and therefore don't take the easy road and indeed charter a plane and fly people to that nice tax country, because it's not going to work. It's about relevant substance, it's about functions they perform, and the role in the value chain of the corporation. Disputes. Just a few disputes already going on. First of all, Nokia India, where Nokia was selling telephones in India and it was not a success. So they had a building somewhere in India and they tried to sell it, and they just wanted to eliminate, to cut all the activities in India. And India more or less said, wait a minute, you cannot just leave here. You still have to pay for the transfer of money, a withholding tax on a certain payment. The details, you can find them if you want them. You can easily Google on the situation. And then Nokia in Finland, the tax director, appealing, of course, to the situation, said, well, how can you do it? We do have a tax treaty, and the tax treaty, Article 12, says that whenever you have a royalty, you can levy withholding tax. And then, ladies and gentlemen, you get this difficult situation that this tax director is dealing with the tax treaty between the UN and an OECD state. And indeed, the word royalty is in Article 12. But the United Nations state has a different perception of what it means. And many UN, it's not just India, it's many states, with a much more broadened spectrum of application than OECD has. And here you see a situation where a corporation should probably have dived into the consequences of the structure before entering in it. And understanding that whenever you deal with the United Nations states, all these definitions which are used to could still probably have a different meaning. So this is an old an example of existing already situations arbitration can arise. This is still going to the course, and I'm quite convinced that it's going to be difficult on Nokia. The next one is based on the Paris Strategic Directive. This is one of the cases I'm involved in. This U.S. multinational sold a participation, and it was a hedge fund, a participation in a Dutch subsidiary, the 4th of January 2016. So 4 days after the new Parent Subsidy Directive should be implemented. And based on that directive, the Netherlands has demanded increased substance requirements, and has also said that in the Netherlands, we have this corporate income tax obligation on non-resident taxpayers. So a non-resident taxpayer, so a corporation holding shares in a Dutch subsidiary, can be taxed with substantial participation taxation, let me call it this way, provided that that foreign company holds this participation in a more or less abusive situation. And abusive is not just that real abuse. Abuse is, for example, the fact that according to Dutch law, whenever the seller in the US, so the hedge fund, doesn't have substance, as we demand this in the Netherlands in a reverse situation, that the Netherlands can tax the capital gain on the shares in the Dutch corporation. So what happened here? A hedge fund sells the shares in the Dutch corporation, taxes the Dutch tax authorities say this is a sale of a participation, we can levy a capital gain tax because in the US we don't see the same substance as we demand vice versa in the Netherlands. And this is a logical thing because most hedge funds are empty corporations which actually use the people of supporting corporations. And the same was going on here. And apparently we could still, under the US Dutch Model Tax Convention, save part of the money for the underlying participants in the hedge fund, but still some double tax is still going to be to the court and to see whether the Dutch implementation will be correct. So here already you see that the new rules, this is the new rule, leads again to a new situation. The same situation is happening with Portugal and Spain, based again on the, under the parent subsidy directive, and specifically the principal purpose test. Already discussed it. They just say this is a situation where tax is one of the principal purposes, so therefore we pick the higher withholding tax. Italy is clear. Italy is just saying to, and there's now a complaint filed with the European Commission. In transfer pricing disputes, Italy just says, well, we only deal with you whenever you want to accept that you sign here, that you don't go for a mutual agreement procedure. And of course, the deal is always more expensive than you expect. So that's more like a very difficult situation of abuse of law from a government perspective. Let's go to the next slide. Not sure what's okay. Yeah. So it's clear there are many principles. It's clear that these principles are going to affect your business. It's clear that the future of international taxation is disputes. But these principles are not one uniform set of rules. There will be many different ways of implementation all over the world. And tax inspectors taking views, ministries of finance taking specific views, which you have to bring to the court. And whenever you bring a case to the court, you have to know what the intention was of the organizations actually defining these principles. And so whenever the difference of implementation probably creates a variety of rules all over the world, they will still be based on more or less comparable approaches of the states and the organization who came up with these rules. And so you have to keep that in mind. So whenever India has different approach than Taiwan and China and Malaysia, they all have different approaches in a certain situation. These deviating approaches are based on their perception of these principles, and you can expect that the courts in most of the states, these courts have an independent view, and therefore understanding these principles is one of the tools you will need to be successful in any situation where you have a conflict with the state. Let's go to the next slide, please. So as said, in a situation where you have a discussion, there are three ways to solve this. First of all, negotiation with the state. You have to know that in more and more states, the tax inspectors and the Ministry of Finance are aware of these developments. 5 years ago, probably more than half of the states, tax administrators had no clue what was going on. And sometimes they just asked for some taxes to be paid in whatever it was, wage taxes or VAT. I've seen examples which are really crazy. But more and more this is going to change. OECD, of course, has its capacity building initiative. ATEF, the Organization of African Countries, is actually training intensively the African countries. In Asia, comparable initiatives are going on. So tax administrations, ministries of finance are really at the moment creating knowledge, building knowledge to make sure that they will be able in any court case to challenge the position you are actually challenging. So understanding the principles and probably being able to challenge them in a debate is essential. But whenever you would try to go for a negotiation, make sure that you understand why rules are here, because at the moment that you have to deal with this, with the tax inspector, also really understanding what the intention is. You have a discussion on the details of these rules, and therefore it's essential that you need to be all up to speed with this. Negotiation is being used a lot in Western countries. Be aware that there's always a discussion of fine, what's in it for us. So countries do also want to benefit one way or another, and I'm not going to give away everything normally. And as I said, we here at this case, what we can do for you, many of the things, whether it's about principles like DEMPI, whether it's about things with the PPT, how to see it, what's abuse, permanent establishment issues, withholding tax issues, all these issues, whenever you need the support that you need in order to negotiate this with the tax administration, we can help you with. Mediation, in some situations, and it's the favorite alternative for United Nations, but also, as said, under the MLI, one of the alternatives, mediation can get very important. And whenever you have the idea that negotiation is not a good way forward, and going to the court is also not very beneficial, there are some states where going to the court will at least mean that you have uncertainty for at least more than 10 years, probably at least one of these examples. Mediation could help to get clearer clarity in a notice, and that could be quite welcome, of course, for companies. So mediation is going to be much more important. It will not always work. Simply because in the United Nations rules, for example, it's the mediation could lead to the situation where the states just have to decide we cannot find the solution. That situation, that's what you have to weigh. Because whenever there's a chance that countries cannot come to a solution, then going to the court is probably the best way forward. And that's something you really have to weigh to discuss. And yeah. Even that discussion we can help you with, because it's not so that you can go for both ways. Sometimes it's possible, sometimes it's not. It's depending on the situation. Okay, go to the course. Not many companies have the experience of going to the court. And in the past, international tax law, let us be honest, was easy business, because it was based on legal, was based on rules, and therefore whenever contractually IP was in whatever tax haven, nobody would challenge this, because there were contracts, underlying contracts, and some states had this different view, but in principle old-fashioned international tax planning was simple work. It's going to be much, much more difficult nowadays. I always say to my clients, in order to go to the court, make sure that you have all the facts cleared up. And make sure that, and that's also with a view on the future, that your value chain is well understood, not just because you know you understand your own value chain, but also the way you present the chain in your documentation helps with a future perspective in solving issues with states, simply because you limit the discussions on the facts. And still, many of the current international tax disputes deal with situations where countries believe that the facts are different from the documentation provided by the company. And when that's the situation, it's always much more difficult. So, but also courts, judges, there are at the moment training programs going on for judges all around the world on EU level, for the European Court of Justice, on international level, for judges of United Nations states, etc., to bring them up to speed with the new principles. So understand that this is it's not like in the past that you can convince with a very good plea a court. You really have to go into dive into the technical things. Again, the deep knowledge is essential to make it a success. So let's go to
Professor Igor has a question. He's just written deep knowledge of whom.
What we present here is, but let's do the questions a little bit later. Okay. What we present here is what we can do for you, for the clients, and we can support them with providing the knowledge to be more successful in the court case. That's actually the next slide. So, how can we help? We have a lot of experience in supervising court cases in many states. What helps is reputation. By not bringing all cases to the courts, but the cases with a decent underlying pattern of facts is one of the things which builds reputation. So there are cases which you just cannot do simply because, as said, the documentation is totally different from what's actually going on. So you actually tried to mislead the tax administrations. So reputation is key. We believe that we have the reputation to deal with this and to help you with these things. Understanding the new principles is key. We believe that we also can help you here and discuss with you how to approach things. As you might see, we can also help you in being expert witness or just support you in another way in these kind of situations. What we have done in the past, just for myself, in the Netherlands, I've run many court cases. I've run court cases also before the European Court of Justice. The old capital tax we had in the Netherlands is actually being abolished after I won a court case against the Netherlands for the European Court of Justice. And I also supported in the past a few in Asia, but many cases by my former employer when I was Deloitte partner in Italy, France and Germany. So understanding the difference in culture are indeed things which are quite important. So how does it work? The last slide, please. So, first of all, understand the facts. Making sure, also for the future perspective, your VCA is in line. So you have a very decent value chain analysis available. Understanding the way the country looks at these facts, where your support is needed of the people of your country, and if you don't have that support, we have our network and we will get the information from our network on how the approach is of the tax administration in a specific country. Stating the facts, understanding the potential response is of course one of the main issues in that situation. We can interpret the facts in relation to the principles and make sure that that helps you bringing a successful case to the court. And then the last slide, I think it's the last slide, the second slide, sorry, yeah. So first of all, what you normally do is bring us a written description of the facts and the points of view of the tax inspector and yours. And of course, whenever it's not in English, please translate it in English. We will always start with a feasibility study. We will also just look at the facts and circumstances, the principles in place, and see what the chances of success are. If we decide with you to bring it forward, we will find you your line of defense, bring you the arguments based on the principles which we discussed with you. And we can in the negotiation phase, also if you want us to join you in a meet with tax administration to either pre-discuss with you or discuss with the tax administration and bring probably reputation and a specific convincing argumentation to the table and see whether you can find the solution already in the negotiation process. When necessary, if necessary, we can provide you with a mediator. We have very sound contacts with best mediators in the world, actually, that's really true. People who can help you, who we can ask to step in, which are probably acceptable by the states also to function as a mediator in a situation, but only when this is possible, and as said, it's not always possible. And that's the last slide. And so the support we can deliver, in summary, is content-driven support in all kinds of phases, in the negotiation phase, in the feasibility phase, but also in the court case where we can take the expert witness kind of situation. We can help you with writing documents, making sure that they're to the point, that they're based on the principles and a challenging approach. And as said, also, as I did in the past, I joined my colleagues in many court cases in Germany and Italy, mostly in limited France, where I just helped in whenever there were difficult discussions. Okay, fine, this is the situation, this is the approach, and this is the way you should bring it forward. So that's in a nutshell, in just this overview of 1 hour, how we can help you. And we are building our team currently, which makes sure that which can help you actually around the globe. You can contact me on this email, contact me via Transfer Pricing Associates or directly one of the people at Transfer Pricing Associates. We're very pleased to help you and looking forward to your response.